Connie Martinson Talks Books. If you have looked at your computer and you write to yourself, or even you have a good sister who writes to you and it goes, OMG, are you fat? Well, I got a book for you. It is called Foodaholic, The 7 Stages to Permanent Weight Loss. It's written by my guest, Irene Rhubarb Keller, LMFT, published by Mill Press. What is LMFT, Irene?
That's a licensed marriage and family therapist.
Aha. Uh-huh. And under, well, I guess food and weight come under both marriage and all of the other problems that go with being a therapist.
Yes, it does.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You talk in the book about how you lost 50 pounds.
I did.
Okay. When were you OMG to yourself?
I was OMG 21 years ago. And I started using food for medication, you know, like an addict would use a drug. So I was in denial that I was gaining weight for a really long time. I was just coming home after work and eating and eating and eating until I passed out, basically. And then finally one day I was just walking in the store and there were all these mirrors at angles I wasn't expecting, you know. And out of the corner of my eye, I saw this big lady. I said, oh, that's a big lady. And then I started thinking, I'm like, you know what? She's got the same color sweater on as I do. Isn't that funny? And then I keep walking and I got the courage to look a little closer and I saw myself.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe that I was that big.
Yeah. Then what did you do? What was the step or the cataclysmic moment that said, I can't take it anymore?
There were lots of them. It actually had to be a process of deciding to do something about it. So there was that moment where I saw myself the way I really looked,
yeah,
which was one. And then I had to make the decision to change. So since I couldn't believe I really looked like that, I had to do some reality testing.
Yeah.
So I asked a good friend, and this friend was always extra nice. And so I said, Susie, do you think I'm overweight? Expecting her to say, oh, you look fabulous.
Yeah.
No, right? She said, well, you could stand to lose a few pounds.
Yeah.
Okay, so then that was it.
Yeah.
That's what did it.
Then what was your first step? Because you talk about go have some pictures taken, see how you really look.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We don't see ourselves, you know, because our eyeballs are inside our heads. We can never, ever see ourselves. We can see everything else in the universe but us. We can only see when we look down or from a reflection in a mirror or from a photograph, but we can't ever really see what we look like.
Yeah.
So the first thing I did was get on the scale.
Yeah.
I hadn't been doing that. I didn't want to know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was getting up to like 190 pounds.
That's heavy.
Uh-huh.
And then when you're doing that or at that weight, as I have known people to be, you buy what I would call the moo-moos. You don't, you will maybe be fine during the day, but there is something called, I think, late night syndrome, where suddenly you should put a lock on the refrigerator.
Yes, that's what was happening for me. It wasn't moo-moo season, so I would wear leggings and boots, which were very cool,
mm-hmm,
and big sweaters.
Yeah.
Lots of big sweaters and jewelry.
Uh-huh. And those people also are very good about having their nails done, their hair done, but they forget what it's hanging on.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Right. But then once you're aware, once you know, once you get on the scale, you see pictures, your good friend tells you, you know what,
yeah,
you need to do something about it. Then it's sort of time to decide, you know, either I'm going to stay like this,
yeah,
or I'm going to change.
I thought it was interesting you said about people gaining weight at law school, and it's sort of see what you look like when you're going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are lots of different times when people tend to gain weight. Law school tends to be a really fattening experience for a lot of people.
Yeah, while you're sitting, you're reading, and you're nervous.
Yeah.
Yeah. As a therapist, are you aware of your patients having had the problem with nerves of going to the refrigerator?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It doesn't matter what the feeling is. If it's an uncomfortable feeling, it can lead people to eat. The eating is actually something that activates the reward pathways in the brain, just like do drugs of abuse. So the high fat, high salt, high sugar foods, the processed foods, actually cause us to get a little bit high. So if you're feeling highly anxious and you go for the cake or the chips, it'll bring you down a little bit.
So it
actually works in the moment, but it only lasts for a few minutes, and then you have the problem of the excess weight.
Yeah. Is it worth it then to substitute the fat food at night for, say, a yogurt or an Activa, something that is less destructive?
Absolutely. Yeah, and I talk about that a lot in the book, about how if you're going to lose weight, and hopefully people that are going to buy the book will, you're not going to stop all the behaviors that got you there in the first place, but you can mitigate the damage. So if you can choose lower calorie foods and still do the behavior, but not as many calories, you will start to see the weight come down.
And also, if you will start to walk, you don't have to run, you don't have to swim, just walk. Even, I mean, I do like a treadmill, but forget the treadmill. You don't have one, walk.
Yes. Any kind of movement is good.
Yeah. And I love the fact that at every end of every chapter, you sort of done a précis of it for people to follow. Mm-hmm. So that even here on in the second chapter, you're saying to people about what they can do, go try on some clothes and write down what size you wear. That is your before size. Imagine what you will do with all your big clothes when you lose the weight. Yeah. Well, that's awful, because then you think, I spend all that money and I won't have anything. But you can make a donation.